You really have to watch what you say from the pulpit, because there one time when I was telling people one of the 10 principles of success is to get rid of what you don't want to make room for what you do want. And this gal came up, she goes, "Listen, does that have to do with my husband?" I said, "Wait, no. We've been preaching through the book of John, and so if you'll turn to John, the 6th chapter, and we'll get into this, and then we've got a little something we want to share at the end of this, but I want to tell you, in case I have forgotten to tell you this, I tell my wife all the time that I love her. But I tell you guys that too, because I do. Debbie and I are privileged to be the pastors here, and we love you very dearly. And thank you, I appreciate that. And I've had people say, "Well, man, don't you get tired making visits all the time and stuff like that?" You know what? I want to tell you, do you ever get tired doing what you really want to do? Not really. I mean, I'm serious. And I've had people say, "Well, when are you going to retire?" I said, "Retire to what? Isn't retirement when you finally get to do what you always wanted to do?" Well, I'm doing it. So I ain't going anywhere. Amen. Hallelujah. So in John, the 6th chapter, in the New Living Translation, and if you don't like the New Living, then get over it. But it says, after this, after what? All that he told us that he did, John told us in the 5th chapter, which actually made up about a year of Jesus' ministry. After this, Jesus crossed over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Sea of Tiberias. I crossed over the Sea of Galilee on a boat when I went to Israel, and I thought it was so cool that on the way over, a big storm came up. So I'm looking over the edge to see Jesus walk up on the water, but he never did that, so anyway. But I thought it was pretty cool, because when you go there and you walk through, and we'll do that as a church deal. We need to set it far in the future, but we'll go over there as a church and walk the streets and walk where Jesus walked, and you'll recognize some of these places from the stories you've read in the Bible, and it makes the Bible just come alive for you. But we'll do that. So would you guys, some of you want to do that as a church and go to Israel? Really good time. So anyway, a huge crowd kept following him wherever he went, because he saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. You might think that that's a great thing, but in reality, we get through these scriptures, we get to understand that Jesus was wanting something deeper than people just to seek him for what he could give to them. Jesus came to seek and save that which was lost. What we are in the spirit, and you know, Jesus already said in the John, the 3rd chapter, that which is flesh, and that which is spirit, his desire was to see people saved. And the signs and wonders, they pointed to a lot of things, but if you look at the signs and wonders he did, they really related to spiritual things as well. And so the truth about it is, he wanted to be in relationship with them. Not just seek. You know, if all I did was approach my wife for what she could give to me, then that'd be a pretty sorry relationship, wouldn't it? But I just love spending time with her. You know, there's times that we'll be able to go, we'll go somewhere, and she goes, "Well, where do you want to go to eat?" I said, "I don't care, as long as I'm with you. I don't really care. I don't care where we're going, but I just want to be with her." And you develop that close relationship with somebody else. And it really is kind of a picture of where God wants us to be with Jesus, his son. That's why in Ephesians, the 5th chapter, it talks about the relationship between the bride and the groom is just like the relationship between the church and Christ. And he wants us. I remember one time when I'd had lunch with my wife and I was driving away, and I thought, "Man, I love that woman." And the Lord spoke to me and said, "What is it you're feeling?" "I'm feeling my love." Oh, I said, "It's deeper than that." He said, "Who am I?" And I said, "Well," and I brought that, and that scripture came up in my mind in John, the 4th chapter, where it said, "God is love." Anybody ever grab your grandchild and you physically feel in your heart this wonderful feeling that you have when you hold them? And you do that with your spouse if you have a good relationship with your spouse. And so the Lord really ministered to me that a lot of people feel the presence of God who always say, I've never felt the presence of God, but they feel the presence of God many times in their life when they experience real love with another human being, because all real love comes from God. Amen? So you have experienced His presence. But they are seeking just what they can get from Jesus, and that's it. A great multitude didn't actually believe in Him in a saving way as a Savior. They didn't trust Him. That's the reason they questioned Him all the time. They wanted Him because He could make them well. They wanted Him because He could feed them. They could get what they wanted out of Him. That's why John said at the very beginning in John 2:25, he said that Jesus needed not that any should testify of man, for He knew what was in man. How many of you know God knows what's in us? Amen. He knows what's going on inside of us. And so Jesus didn't commit Himself to the crowd back there in Jerusalem. He's not going to commit Himself to this crowd here either. In the third verse, then Jesus climbed a hill and sat down with His disciples around Him. By the way, He spent more time teaching His disciples than anybody else. It's a picture of what the church should be. You come here and you get teaching through the Word, then your job is to bring it to other people and teach them. Amen? And so then Jesus climbed a hill and sat down with His disciples around Him. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. Remember what the Passover was? It celebrated the Jews being delivered out of the hand of Pharaoh. And the death angel was killing all the firstborn. But if they would put the blood over the door, the blood of the unblemished lamb over the door, then the death angel would pass over their house and their firstborn wouldn't die. And so they established this feast of the Passover to remember that. So Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people come and look for Him. And turning to Philip, He asked, where can we buy bread to feed all these people? Well, that's what He said. He said, where can we buy? Not can we buy bread. But none of that was really what He's trying to do. What He's really trying to test Philip. Does Philip really understand what He's capable of doing? He's asking for advice from Philip. Do you really think that's true? You think our Lord really needed to ask anybody what would be the best solution to a problem? No, not really. And so He had 5,000 men plus the women and children, so they really figured there was a crowd of about 15,000 at the time. And Jesus didn't ask the question about food because He needed some advice or because He was deciding what He was going to do. He already knew. He's going to tell us in a minute. He already knew what He was going to do. But He was trying to get His disciples involved in the miracle. And you find out over and over in the Word of God that God really likes us involved in the miracle. I even remember the man that was lame at the gate, and he was asking alms, asking for money. But his greatest need in life wasn't money. By the way, I've got news for you, any of you that think your greatest need is money, it's not. And so he thought his need was money. But what the disciples tell him, well, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I unto thee. And then they grabbed Him and lifted Him up. Why did they grab Him and lift Him up? Because God wants them involved in the miracle. And He wants the one who's getting the miracle to be involved in the miracle. Amen? God wants us. When Jesus said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light, He didn't say we didn't have a yoke. It's just that we are yoked like oxen are yoked together. We're yoked with Jesus, and we're moving through this world and accomplishing great things because Jesus is with us. There's still something we have to do, isn't there? Amen? Well, I mean, why didn't God just part the Red Sea as soon as the children of Israel got there? But yet He told Moses to stretch out His staff, which was a symbol of His authority. He likes us to be involved in the miracles that are happening. You might remember that when you start praying for a miracle for somebody to happen for somebody, you might remember that you're part of that miracle to happen for somebody. Amen? So anyway, he got them involved. You know, when He was turned the water into wine, He got the disciples involved in that in John 2, 1 through 11, what they call the first miracle that He did. But we see what Philip is doing. Philip is looking around, and he's trying to decide now how can he come up with a solution to the problem that Jesus presented. We have all these people here. We need to feed them. Where are we going to buy food? So he goes around looking, trying to find out what can I say, what a question to get. Where am I going to find the food? And how are we going to buy? And you know, in the natural, there's no way to feed 15,000 people. I don't know how to do that. At that time there was a lot of hungry people anyway, naturally, because they didn't have the food that they should have had. But he was trying to get them all involved in the miracles. He again asked his disciples what they do to, at another time, he invited them, well, how are you going to feed the 4,000? They didn't even remember that Jesus had just fed 5,000. Later on, he feeds 4,000, and they forget that miracle. What is it about us? Have we forgotten all the good things God's already done? I want to tell you, I don't know what's going through you in your life right now, but I guarantee you the God of miracles is still alive. And whatever it is that's going on inside of your life, I want to tell you, God is bigger than the problem that you're going through. God cares about what's happening with you. You may think he's forgotten you, but he's not forgotten you. Amen? So, you know, the truth about it is that we often try to find everything we can do first. We need something great to happen inside of our life. We may have said, God, I need some help here. Then we go about trying to fix it. I want to be involved in the miracle that God's doing, but I don't for a moment want to tell God how he needs to operate. I don't want to tell him that. I just have great faith he's going to take care of me. That's why when people start, you know, we got people now that are worried. They're going back to heaven. You want to dig a bunker, fill it with food, because everything's going to fall apart. Well, while you're living your Buckner, God will still be meeting all my needs according to his riches and glory. Amen. So I'm not building a bunker anywhere. I don't want to live underground. There might be spiders. And I don't want to eat food like that they served you in the military. I don't want any of that kind of stuff. So anyway, so really what Jesus was doing, he was testing Philip. And it says in the scripture he was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. So Jesus asked his question to Philip, how are we going to feed everybody, when Jesus already knew what he was going to do? And Philip replied, even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed him. But Philip was fixed on the sum of money that he had inside the treasury. That's what he did. He's fixing on how much money they had. They had about what would have been 200 days of wages. A penny in the Roman Empire was really a Roman denarius. And so it was like a day's wage. They had about 200 days' wages. But it still wasn't enough to feed 15,000 people. And he's going to feed them all. Then it says, then Andrew, Simon's Peter brother, spoke up. Why? Because Andrew went about trying to find a solution to the problem. Now, anytime you read scripture, find out how it relates to you. What problem do you have that right now you're trying to find a solution for? You think that you're smart enough to do it, but I know you, you're not. And we weren't really designed in this world. We were designed to help each other, but we weren't designed to try to accomplish all the miracles on our own. God is the miracle worker, and we just work with him. Amen? Then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up, said, there's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and a bottle of Cracker Jacks. No, he didn't say that. 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with this huge crowd? Now, I want to tell you, first of all, those barley loaves were not like big, huge loaves. They were like what we have now in a hamburger bun. They weren't very big. They were a lunch for this child. You know, that's what it was for this young man. And so already they're still looking at the natural. We got some barley loaves and fish. This young man's got here. Let's see. We got some money in the treasury, but not enough money to feed them. I got a little bit of a lunch here, but how's that going to do it? I don't understand how that's going to work. It's not big enough to do all we got to do. It's a hopeless project. I want to tell you, I love this about God. God's vision is so big that he usually, I didn't say part of the time, but he usually calls us to accomplish a project that's way bigger than what we can do, because he wants us to rely upon him. He wants us to live a life of faith. If you only do in your life what it looks in the natural like you can accomplish it, you'll never accomplish much with your life. But if you're willing to reach out and say, I can do great things because I serve a great God. He's called me to this task, and if he called me to it, he's going to empower me to it. He is going to provide the resources to do it. I'm telling you, we're going to get this thing done. Me and Jesus are working together. Amen? You know, you don't have to raise your hand, but I think there's probably people here that have budgets that actually try to operate off of budgets. But did you know when you figured out what your liabilities are and what your assets are, when you get down to your assets, when you get done figuring out your assets, you ought to put your assets plus Jesus. Your assets plus Jesus. Because if your mind, your whole life, and your heart is set on just what your assets are, you'll be very limited in what you can accomplish. But man, what I have plus the power of Jesus, I can accomplish anything. Amen. I know there's people that miss their miracles because they don't understand that. They're only looking at what they have. I remember years ago, there was a young couple that approached me and they said, we want to bring you our finances. And they said, we want to prove to you that we can't pay our tithe. I said, you think it's scriptural to pay tithe? Yes. He said, we want to prove to you that we can't. So they brought me their finances. They had so many credit cards and stuff. And they said, do you see now? There's no way we can pay our tithe. And I said, yeah, there's a way. He said, what way? Work another day. And he goes, I already work 5 days a week. I said, well, the Bible says 6 days shall a man work and rest on the seventh. And I said, so work that extra day so you can quit robbing God and start giving God what he's supposed to have. Well, I don't want to do that. Well, then just take your finances back. How serious are we about it with God? How serious are we? I don't hear an amen or an oh me. But the closer we draw to Jesus, the more we start understanding that the little bit I have seems like, don't just think about money. There are people in here that may not have any money, but you have some time that you can give. You've got something to offer God. You have something that you can give to God. And guess what? The principle is this. It can't multiply until you give it away. You can't, God's not going to multiply what he doesn't have. I've watched people struggle in their finances for years and they never get a hold of that. Not going to, you can't multiply what you're unwilling to release. Amen. But this young man, he got some loaves and fishes. We're going to see in a little bit that God multiplied it. So then Jesus says, tell everyone, sit down. And so they all sat down on grassy slopes. The men alone numbered about 5,000. Now Jesus is getting ready to feed the multitude. You have 15,000 people to feed. That's a bit of a liability. That's a little tough to figure out. Because if all you got is 5 loaves and 2 fish and 200 denarii, your assets aren't very much. But your assets plus Jesus is more than enough. The Bible says that he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that I ask or think, according to the power that works in us. And the power that works in us is faith. Amen? Then Jesus, oh Lord, I don't remember where that scripture is. Scripture in the Bible says that there are those that scatter and have plenty and those that hold on and have nothing. In the 11th verse, then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and distributed them to the people. Actually, he did that through the disciples. Afterward, he did the same with the fish, and they all ate as much as they wanted. They all ate as much as they wanted. I've been to the buffet with some of you. That's a lot of food. They ate as much as they wanted. Why was it necessary We do the same thing when we try to help people here. We try to help people at Christmas and stuff. We don't want to give them just the bare necessity of what will get them by, but we want to show them the abundance of God. Amen. God likes to show himself to be an abundant God, that he's able to do far above anything that we can ask or think. He loves to show himself. Why? Because it's Jesus himself said it was more blessed to give than to receive. Would you really expect for him to operate any different way than that? He loves to give. He loves it. If you got five loaves plus two fishes plus Jesus, man, you really got something. Without Jesus, you don't have anything at all. Listen to me. Without Jesus, you don't have anything at all, no matter how much you possess. So Jesus told them to sit down, and they sat down. Mark emphasizes the fact that, the Gospel of Mark emphasizes the fact they sat down in companies. Each groups of people which had come to a certain section sat down. I bet if you were looking at it from another hill and saw, it would look like a patchwork quilt. Different companies of 50 or whatever set out there, but he had a big job to do. After everyone was full, somebody say full. Well, what does this do to that theology? Every time I turn around, somebody's saying, I don't believe in that prosperity message. Well, then live according to the poverty message. Because I believe in the prosperity message. Not that God's going to have you win the lotto. Can I tell you what God blesses? Work and faith. I've had people come to this church say, I never can get ahead. You got a job? No, get a job. Well, I don't want to take any job. I'm used to making a lot of money. How much are you making now? Well, nothing. Then you take anything. Maybe I don't think right, but. Don't shake your head yes when I say things like that, babe. But he's a God that wants everyone full. He isn't a God of, hey, I want everybody just to have barely enough to make it. Because the truth about it is he wants you to have enough in your life that you can help the other ones that don't have enough in their life. That's what he wants. You think he cares about multi-million dollar houses and cars, but that's not what he's interested in. He's interested in people. He wants us to be blessed. He doesn't care if you live in a nice house and drive 9 nice cars. But the truth about it is, he wants you to put him first. Amen? So after everyone was full, say it again, full. Jesus told his disciples, now gather the leftovers so that nothing's wasted. A miracle was performed. A miracle that these hungry people, that nobody without anything, but not only that, they all were full. Even the boy who had the fishes and loaves to begin with ate his full, and there was still stuff left over. He's the God of more than enough. You got to get that down in your soul, in your mind, will, and emotions. He's the God of more than enough. He likes you to have more than enough. But listen, if you hold on to what you got, this is mine, and God ain't touching it, you haven't planted anything for him to bless you with anyway. Jesus provided such an abundance, there was 12 baskets full of fragments left over. Amen. I can just see those people going back, and people are going, what are you carrying this, doggy bag? I got all my fill, and they gave me a doggy bag. Verse 13, so they picked up the pieces and filled 12 baskets with scraps left by the people who had eaten from the 5 barley loaves. That means the crowd got all that they wanted. And people in that land in that day were often hungry. They were first times, I bet there were people there for the first time in their life had eaten all that they wanted. Did you know that we take it for granted that we can eat all we want in this country? We do. Yet, we that are going to Haiti, if people haven't been there before, you'll find there's a whole lot of people don't have anything. They don't have anything. And matter of fact, did you know that in Haiti, they're absolutely sure that I'm prosperous. Do you know why? I'm being serious. The truth about anybody that can eat enough to get a belly like this has got to be a very wealthy man. Why do they think that? Because they don't have anything. But God's the God of more than enough. I want to tell you, I guarantee you that God wants them to be blessed, wants their socks blessed off. I'm telling you. In the 14th verse, when people saw him do this miraculous sign, they exclaimed, surely he's the prophet we've been expecting. When Jesus saw they were ready to force him to be king, he slipped away into the hills by himself. This is the verse that proves that they didn't understand what was going on. God cared about their spirits more than anything else. He wanted to be in relationship with them. But all they could think of is, what can Jesus give to me? How can he make my physical existence better? Can he heal me? Can he feed me? Can he give me the things I really desire? And that's what they felt like. That's not what God's really trying to do here. God wants us to hunger for him, to be in love with his presence. Amen? And Jesus wanted that. So they wanted to take him by force and make him the king. They didn't know that the one they were trying to make king was already the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. But it wasn't his time yet to sit on the throne of David and rule. That wasn't his time yet. And so Jesus has to get away from them. They were missing the point. They're following him because he's a miracle worker. He probably had to perform a miracle just to get away from that crowd. He got free from them because they wanted to make him a king. Do you know the Bible says that he was tempted in every way that we're tempted? Do you ever ponder on that a little bit? Think of all the different ways you've been tempted in your life. Jesus was tempted in all those ways, yet he did not sin. That means when they were tempted to exalt him to a position that he didn't have a right to take at that point, when they tried to do that, he was tempted. I'm sure he was tempted to, I mean, who wouldn't? If they grabbed one of you and said, we're going to make you a king, you'd be tempted. And I'm sure he was tempted. But man, the Bible tells us in Hebrews that he always had his mind and thoughts fixed upon his Father and the glory that was waiting for him. So he wasn't going to be distracted by the things of this world. We are so distracted by the things of this world. And God wants us to focus on a right relationship with Christ. Amen. So what's he do? He withdraws from everyone. And we're going to end with this. But he withdraws from everyone. And he goes and starts talking to the Father, starts praying to the Father. The antidote for being full of yourself is spending time with the Father in prayer. I mean, no matter what temptation comes to you, when you spend time with the Father, look what we learned here today. We're not going to go further because we get further in this chapter. Jesus is going to walk on the water. He's going to start this great discourse. Because they had just seen the miracle of feeding the 5,000, he's going to start on this great discourse where he starts talking about that he was the true bread of life. And we'll handle that next week. So we're going to end it right here. But I want to tell you, whatever miracle it is that you need inside of your life, you only have one place to turn, and that's to Jesus. Amen? One place. But remember this, he's a jealous God. He wants you to be in love with him for his presence and not just seek what he can give you. Does that make sense to anybody here? There'll be a test. Whenever you get the word of God and you walk out, did you know the devil immediately tests you? The Bible says the devil comes along and wants to steal the word that you just received. So you need to rehearse it in your mind and say that you're not going to be caught by that. We're going to have an altar call here in a minute, but I want to have somebody share something with you real quick. Aaron, if you want to come up here. I don't want you to think I forgot her. She has something to share. Then she's going to do a top hat and cane dance routine for us. Was that right?
No.
Oh, no. Let me get you a mic. Does this mic work?
Check.
All right. So like Pastor mentioned, we're going to Haiti, and we are trying to get, we have six youth who are going, and we're trying to get all the funds raised to get them there. And if we go above and beyond that, we can do more to help the people of Haiti with planting trees, helping replace roofs, and all sorts of things like that. So while we're there, we're going to be staying on a mission that has a hospital, a school, a church, an orphanage. They do all sorts of stuff for the people of Haiti, and we're going to be going into homes as well to gather information for the mission on how to help the people of Haiti and to minister to the families and the people in Haiti. This is going to be an extremely eye-opening experience for these youth. It's going to be just indescribable, the difference it will make in their lives and the difference we can make in the people of Haiti's lives that we touch while we're there. So we are doing an envelope board, and there's envelopes numbered 1 through 100. Some have already been filled. And we're just asking that you guys come up and fill those envelopes with the dollar amount that is on the envelope. And we are also going to have retro prom again, and the funds for that will be going to Haiti. It's going to be February 18th. It's going to be at the town hall in Buckner. It's $10 a ticket. And at retro prom, we're going to be doing, and we're selling them now, raffle tickets, and we're going to draw that raffle at retro prom, and it's over like $200 worth of gift cards and oil changes, pizza from Casey's, and all sorts of stuff. Can my youth that are here that are coming to Haiti come up here? I'm going to have them say a little bit of something too. Any help, anything you guys do to help us get to Haiti and to support us in this is greatly appreciated.
I'm really excited to see the eye-opening experiences I've heard from my youth leaders, and I just think it's going to be an amazing experience, and I'm really glad I get to go.
I'm just really excited because, like Pastor said earlier, just to be able to spread the word of God. I think that's the number one goal as a Christian, is our mission is to be able to spread the word of God and teach other Christians.
Amen.
All right. So we will be selling retro.
She forget you? You didn't want to say anything?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We made Tony talk before, so.
Oh, okay.
I won't make him do it again this time. But we are selling these raffle tickets and the retro prom tickets outside the door as you guys leave. And if you guys could come up and fill the envelopes, that would be a huge help. Thank you.
Amen. Give him a round of applause. Amen, amen, amen. Let's stand to our feet. You probably think it was planned when I said you have to plant what you have, then got her up here to talk about helping in Haiti. You know what I'm saying? Well, it was. No. You have something to share or something?
I'd just like to get a special prayer for all of us that are going to be homeless today.
Oh, awesome. We got guys going to go take care of the homeless today. Isn't that good? And I want you to notice that some of them look great, some of them look like they're homeless. But let's just stretch out your hand towards them. Father, we just thank you and we praise you right now. We thank you that you're anointing. He said, unless the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. So I thank you, Lord God, for your anointing on these men as they go forward, Lord God, spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ, helping clothe and bring food to the homeless. I thank you right now for blessing them in this endeavor. And I thank you that your spirit is, they are filled with your spirit. And everywhere they go, Lord God, they're impacting the people they touch. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I love to see the church at work. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Well, did you get any smarter today? All right, all right. Let's raise our hands. So repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much that you love me, that you take care of me. I thank you that you call me to do things that require great faith. I thank you that what I have plus Jesus can accomplish anything. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Well, hug on somebody before you leave, whether they want you to or not.